All right, so we wanted to get into your experience with the contract, and you missed a full year. Historic moment in the NHL.
Yeah, like Pex, how did it start out? Did your agent, what was the plan going into it? Did he say, we're gunning for this, and if we don't get it, we're prepared to sit? Because as players, you want to play. Like, how does the interaction work as far as the initial, you know, training camp starting and missing it and then the season? Like, just take us into that, how it all went down.
Yeah, well, I think initially there's a range, I think, you know, as far as the monetary value and possibly even the term that you'd be happy with. You know, and I think if I go back even a year before that, in the last year of my contract before that, I had hired Don Meehan Newport Sports, and I think that kind of gave the impression that Darcy were here in the Sabres that, okay, I'm kind of gearing up for a tough negotiation a year from now, and it's kind of what it was. I think, you know, for me, it's always about, you know, I just want to be what's fair. You know, I do feel silly saying that. It for me, it was really never about the money. You always want to get what's fair. And you kind of leave it to the professionals that you hire to handle that.
But hang on, Pex. If it's not about the money, then how come you end up not going to camp?
Yeah, that's what I'm going to get into. I think the money part is obviously important because you want to do what's fair. In my situation, the Regises own the team here, the owners of Adelphia Cable. And so they had a 24-hour TV and radio sports channel. And right from the start, it was kind of an onslaught on me and kind of a one-sided view and, you know, what I should want and what I should accept and all this stuff. And I knew a lot of other stuff that was going on inside those networks with producers and stuff like that. And so for me, it really became a matter of principle. I'm like, you know what? I'm not going to give in. I'm going to do what's right. And if this is what they're going to do, they're going to do. You know, I think in hindsight, you know, if I was a little bit more involved, and because at the end of the day, I think it was just as important for me to stay a Buffalo Sabre at the time. You know, looking back at my career now, it's hard to think that all that stuff didn't happen for a reason, but I would have loved to have stayed a Buffalo Sabre. But, you know, things kind of outside the actual contract negotiation itself is what kind of really hardened me to the whole process. And, I don't think William Nylander's going through something like that. And, you know, what I heard just before coming out with you guys, I mean, it's hard because I remember going through, you know, listening to people on the radio and different things of, you know, he's not worth it or this is what he should get. And, you know, my situation was a little different where I was, you know, I didn't have the spectacular offensive numbers. I had decent offensive numbers, but I had intangibles. I did other things that I felt contributed to the value I had to the team. So that can become a tricky part of the negotiation as well, where I you know, didn't have probably a rock solid arbitration case or anything like that at the time. But it's hard. I mean, a kid like William Nylander, he sees a lot of other guys signing big contracts, and you know, sometimes timing isn't your friend, and he's on a team where you've got Austin Matthews has a big deal and you've got John Tavares who just signed a big deal and all this stuff going on where they're trying to find a number that works for the team as well. So it's just sometimes an imperfect situation you know, for what he's going through.
With Mike Peca here on Overdrive, at what did you have drop dead dates like during that full season 2000-2001 when you were negotiating with Buffalo and you did not end up playing? At what point during the negotiation did you realize, okay, I'm going to have to get traded here? Like, I'm going to have to go somewhere else. He ended up going to New York.
Yeah, I think as time was evolving, I kind of came to the realization that was going to happen. You know, I'd had calls from GMs, you know, want to see where I was at and different things because they were looking to maybe trade for me at the trade deadline that year. But at the same time, I also knew from inside that they were not going to trade me, that they were going to make me sit the entire year. And I don't know if that was the GM or more of an ownership decision. But I remember in mid-January or something, I remember calling Darcy and just I'd had it at that point. And
you called him personally?
I called him, yeah. He was at a scouting meeting, I believe, out west somewhere. And I just said, look, the basic message was, and, you know, I can no longer see myself ever putting on the Sabres jersey. And I think, you know, take away all the, you know, the banter on both sides. I just wanted to hear, I wanted to hear it from me, not like, oh, Peck has demanded a trade or in the media. I wanted to hear it from me. And he flew back to Buffalo immediately and we met the next day and still couldn't come to any sort of agreement. So that's when I kind of knew, you know, that my days in Buffalo were done. And to be honest with you, you know, during the draft, I got traded that following draft. And on day one, I knew the teams that were interested and what the things that were being offered to Buffalo. And I remember once Phoenix picked, I think it was at number 10, I got pretty upset and I turned to my wife and said, I'm going to end up missing next year too. I just felt like this is going to be really bad. And it turns out I ended up getting traded on day two of the draft for something that was less than what the Islanders were offering, you know, at the trade deadline prior to that. So it was messy. It's never an easy situation for the player to go through. Obviously there's representatives on both sides that handle it, and that's what they're good at. But as a player, it stinks. I mean, because you want to be out there with the guys. I mean, the most awkward thing for me that year is I was at the rink 5 days a week skating, and a lot of times the Sabres would be on the ice right after I was because, you know, if they had a concert or something, they're skating at the where the practice rink was, and I'd be on the ice before them, and I'd always, you know, every once in a while I'd get pulled into a closet with Lindy and ask me how things are going, and the Sabres had a good team that year. I mean, that was a pretty good team, so it is a very difficult situation. I can empathize with what William's going through.